So at the end of the session, we'll be having a trivia quiz, pub quiz, where we'll be picking three winners, and those three winners will be getting the, you know, instructor training vouchers from the BuildSoft. Okay. There are a few instructions for, you know, for the attendees when they they start playing pub quiz. So if you, yeah, we have those instructions in the slides also. But yeah, we'll discuss that when the pub quiz is, you know, going to start. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. So as I said, the agenda will be the complete life cycle. So we'll start with the design specification. Then we'll export it to the Exchange. The complete life cycle where we'll see that it's getting exposed to the internal developers as well as the external client. Okay. And from there we'll start implementing by the help of, you know, Anypoint Studio. And then we'll try deploying without any, without you know, API manager interface. So we'll start with that. Then we add API manager interface with the help of basic endpoint and then proxy. Then we'll see the difference between this basic endpoint, what are the pros and cons by using basic endpoint and the proxy endpoint, how those are helpful either way. And then we'll see what are the types of policies available, okay, where to use which policy, okay, that we'll see in the coming demo part. And we'll after creating a proxy, we'll download and we'll show that proxy is also like a Mule app, okay? So it's like a cross-cutting concerns, right? We see that before execution of your business logic, after execution of your business logic, what will be there in the proxy that we can show you guys in the demo part. Yes. Yeah. So what is API basically? Okay. So I can say that the method or a piece of code, if it is accessible via internet, okay, and we call it API. Okay. So that on top of it, we have modern APIs. We can apply the non-functional requirements. Those are the rest of the part. But before doing that, if I say API, it's a piece of code which is running somewhere and which is accessible via internet. Okay, so that is communication between two. We can say that. Okay, so communication between two systems, communication between any app, application to the application. Okay, so there are multiple examples of that, but the piece of code which is accessible via the internet, we can call it a API. Okay, yeah, next slide please. Yeah, so you can see here today's agenda itself is like the complete life cycle. So we start with the design part, where we'll use a design center, we'll use a RAML. Okay, and we'll write a sample RAML and we'll try to show you that how mock service we can use and test our API there itself and see whether it's working as per our requirement or not. If it works as per our requirement, we'll try to publish it to the Exchange to get the feedback from other developers or from the the clients. Okay, and then once that will be an iteration. So once you get the feedback from your client, you try to fix it, you try to revisit your RAML. And then once the final RAML is done, like your client is satisfied, the developers are satisfied, you'll take it to the implementation part. Before that, other dependent, developers, they can start using your RAML specification itself, because it will be having a mock data exactly like looks like the real data. Okay, so that part, bring us the concurrency in the development. Okay, so our dependent developers can easily start their part. Okay, so this is not the only way we can directly start the development, but as per the API, connectivity concept introduced by BuildSoft, The main catalyst from there is the reusability, discoverability, so that whatever we are producing, those has to be consumed as much as possible. Okay, so there should not be redundancy. So if today if I'm building this API, the other developer or other are also building a similar kind of API. So to avoid that, we can expose this to the exchange and make it discoverable, so that other team or developer or whoever wants to consume, they can come to the exchange, where it's like a one shop. Okay, there you can look for the requirement. You search with your keywords and look for the APIs, whether the APIs are implemented or not. And then your document will be there. What are the methods we are exposed? What are the resources? All those things will be there in the AnyPoint Exchange or API portal. Yeah. So then comes the, once your design part is done, dev and test is done, you'll deploy it to the runtime environment, where you'll say that I want this configuration. Okay, these are my properties. So all those things while deployment, you set it at the runtime manager. That okay. So I need AnyPoint monitoring or all that. So what I'm saying is, during deployment, you can configure your implementation or business logic to accordingly to show you the options there in the deployment. Then operate, right? So here you will be having management part. Here you'll be applying your non-functional requirement. You look for the performance of your API, everything, and all these things will be engaged. Okay, so engagement, right? So every section will be having involvement of your other teams, right? So each section will be a responsibility of different teams. So there the engagement part comes. Next slide. Okay, this is the same thing, yeah, which we have discussed. The design center, we can use the web-based tool, okay? So here we'll be writing our API specification. So API specification, we can write in a different language, but Ubisoft prefers the RAML. But if you're okay with RAML, you can anytime convert into a OS, Open API Specification, or Swagger, we can say that. Anytime you can convert it into a Swagger. Or if you want to convert into other, there are external tools available. You can make use of those tools and convert it into a different OS to RAML, RAML to OS, like that. Okay, and now OS 3.0 also supported. In this, you can write your RAML, or you can import it from Exchange, or you can import it from your system. You can download that. Okay, once your RAML is you're done with that, you can download it. Okay, do that. But we do in the design center. AnyPoint Exchange, as I said, is like a repository or shop for your assets. You here, our context is the API only. Other than API, there will be a fragments, there will be templates, there will be the REST connectors, a lot of things. And it works as a version control also. That's why we are saying that AnyPoint platform is a complete tool, okay? Where once you get the license, you don't need to look for any other tool at all. So this Exchange, you can make use of, make it as a repository, or you can leverage the version control option also here. So that also make use of version control with the help of AnyPoint Exchange. AnyPoint Exchange, with AnyPoint Exchange, we'll get a portal also, where I was saying, right? But once you upload it to the Exchange or expose it to Exchange or publish it to the Exchange, it will be visible to your internal or developers only, right? So then we can, if you want to, publish it for external world, we can go ahead with the API portal, public API portal. Okay. Yeah, so AnyPoint Exchange is also accessible via CI/CD. There are a lot of APIs available, okay? So, AnyPoint, Ubisoft itself expose the APIs, we can make use of those. Next slide, please. Yeah, Studio. Yeah, so it's IDE, right? It's completely based on Java Spring. So here we have inbuilt MUnit, inbuilt Maven, everything. So we can implement our API specification. So here we can start implementing start changing that mock data, okay, and we can connect to the actual systems and then pull the data from there or write the data to that system. And here we can do the connectivity part also, where we can directly connect to the design center, directly connect to the exchange, directly connect to the runtime manager from here itself. You just need to provide your credentials and front platform credentials directly deployed. You can do it from here. You can directly get the RAML from design center or exchange. Okay. And now 7.8 above, we can run the mock service here itself. Okay. We can even write our RAML in the AnyPoint Studio itself. We don't need to go to the design center. So once you create that project here, the automatically it connects to design center and create a RAML project for you. Okay, so and then keep on syncing your AnyPoint Studio changes with the design center, and directly you can publish it from here to the exchange. That we can do. Yeah, so runtime manager. Yeah, as I said, we have discussed it also. While deployment, we can select the target. Okay, we can select our EC2 configurations here. We can configure environment specific properties here. We can configure sensitive properties here. So all those things we can configure. We can enable the So right now it's a trial version, so we are not able to see persistent queues. We can enable persistent queues. By default, we get object store V2. So those things will be configured from here. Okay. This is during deployment. Okay. Yeah. Then comes the API manager. Once your deployment is done, okay. So what you need to do is, and now we need to connect this business logic which is running inside your inside your runtime manager. We can pair it with the API manager interface. Okay. So we can create the API interface here, and then this API interface we can create in two ways. As I said, we can create via basic endpoints, we can create via proxy. So there are pros and cons, we'll talk about that also. So yeah, and then from here you can apply the policies. It can be automated policy, custom policy, or the out of the box policies. Okay. So what is auto discovery basically? So let's say there are two entities, or we can say assets. One is there in the API manager and other is there in the runtime manager. So the API manager asset is nothing but the interface, okay, from where that is the entry point, okay, and that entry point we need to pair it with the project. Okay, so how to do that? So once you get the interface in the API manager, you get an API. That API ID, we need to assign it to AutoDiscovery, and then AutoDiscovery will connect that API interface with the business logic. Okay. So whenever you are applying any policies, those policies will get applied on the gateway, and then there will be a flow routed to the business logic. Yeah. So there are two ways, as we said. Like, so there is a basic point, and now there is a proxy. So proxy is nothing but extra layer. We can say that extra security on top of your business logic. Okay, so it's like again a new app. Okay, which will be deployed to the runtime manager. So when you decide to go with the proxy, so for each API there will be two APIs inside your runtime manager. One for proxy, one for your actual API. So what it does, it actually gives you an extra layer of security. So only in case of basic endpoint, you'll be exposing your actual endpoint to the public. In this case, you'll be exposing your proxy endpoint, and all the non-cross-cutting concerns, right? Like policies, rate limiting, the access, okay? All those things will be applied. That means the policies will be applied on top of proxy endpoint. And once the policies are satisfied, then it will transfer that call or that request to the actual business logic. Okay, while going to the business logic also implementation, and while coming back also it will validate. So both ways it will validate based on your requirement. If you are applying policies that way, it will validate while going, incoming as well as outgoing. So what is the advantage? Advantage is that it's delegating your non-functional requirement responsibility to the proxy endpoint. So that means definitely the performance of your API, actual API, will be faster as compared to the basic endpoint, because that guy is having extra responsibility of applying those policies, validating those policies, everything. Now, cons part of this is it takes the exact 1 vCore, you know, 0.1 vCore of your from your license. So if you are very rich, yeah, I mean, based on again your organization, you can go ahead with the proxy. If you are really worried about your vCores, you can go with the business, basic endpoint. Okay. So, before going to that demo part, we have three types of policies: automated policies and custom policies and out of the box. So out of the box, an automated policy looks same set of policies template will be there, but when to use automate and when to use the out of the box one. So automate policies, I give a use case where let's say your organization has a governance policy saying that your, let's say, one scenario is every API calls, okay, every API calls I need to log the request, the incoming request and outgoing request. That is what your organization governance policy. So what we'll do in the future, coming APIs also on top of it, you want to apply by default, and let's say your 100 APIs already implemented, you want to apply that policy. So you can go ahead directly go to the automated policies. You apply that, it will get applied to all the APIs, and in incoming future APIs also that will get applied. Now comes the, everybody is aware of the out of box policy, right? But how about the custom policies? So in case of custom policies, I give one more use case for custom policies. For example, can you answer me in the chat window? So if I want to apply two policies, okay, one is client ID and client ID enforcement and the basic authentication, okay? So, and I am okay if the user pass either of one. So if you apply that client ID enforcement and the basic authentication inside the our out of the box policies, it will expect to get the values for both the guys, right? Client ID, client secret, as well as basic authentication. But I don't want that way. I want anyone, either of the one, either client ID or basic authentication. Whoever gets the values, I'm okay with that. So in that case, there is no way we can do that in the automated policies or in the out of the box policies. Okay, the only option is to go with the custom policies, right? One more scenario could be, let's say you are running a quiz, let's say, okay? So quiz, when you're running quiz, let's say you put the two profiles, beginner profile and the expert profile. Now your API always returns, your API always returns the question, option and the hints, okay? Now, whenever your expert is logging and asking for the data, that time you don't want to show options and hint because that guy is the expert. Now, if beginners log in and ask for the data, your API should give all three. I can't go and implement this in my business logic, right? So there has to be a policy. We can take care of this non-functional requirement, right? So if beginner comes, it will show the question, options and hint. If expert comes, or if expert log in and ask for the data, it should show only question. Okay, so this kind of policies, this kind of requirement can be implemented via system policies. So these are the three areas we can implement. Now, Balkish, over to you. You can start the demo. If you have any questions,
Sorry to interrupt, Ashish. Have you discussed this basic endpoint and endpoint with proxy differences, or its bulk case will be doing that?
I have explained it abstract way, but in during the demo, during demo we'll try to show you how basic endpoint looks like, how the proxy endpoint looks like, and I already set the context that this will be a basic. Okay.
Okay, got it. Yeah, we have some questions regarding that. So others, like probably bulk case will be explaining with the demo what is basic endpoint and automator. And there are also some questions with regarding custom policies. Yep, I think that's all we have started it. And one more question was regarding the SOAP and the REST differences between SOAP and REST.
So REST and SOAP is like, REST is a lightweight. First difference is REST is lightweight. Okay, there you'll be depending on the HTTP verbs, but in case of SOAP, you need to write your own method. Okay, there. Second difference is it's completely XML based. SOAP is completely XML based, but REST can support your XML, JSON, and other stuff. Okay, so that will be so. That XML or HTTP is like so there in you need to define the schemas for request, schemas for response in XML form. Everything will be communicated in the XML messages.
Okay. Exactly. So on top of that, like SOAP is basically the post request. While we have REST, we can use GET, POST, DELETE, and all. But basically, SOAP uses only POST. And on top of that, the RAML specification, the OA specification that we write is only for REST APIs. It's not supported for SOAP APIs. When it comes to SOAP, the contract is a WSDL document. WSDL is again a contract document where it's all XML based, and it's not endpoint based. REST is an endpoint based. XML is they're exposing the methods completely. So it's method based. Yep. I just wanted to add that. So one more question before we start the demo. So requirement type custom policies, where should the custom policies should be applied? What requirement custom policies should be applied?
Saurav, to answer to your question is one use case I give, right? So let's say there could be multiple use case where we can use a custom policy, but one use case is you want to apply two policies. Okay, concentrate on the question. You want to apply client ID enforcement also and the basic authentication also. Now, unless you provide the client ID and client secret and basic authentication, it won't pass your control to your business logic. I want to do it in the or option. Either they use client ID or client secret, or they pass the basic authentication. In this case, we need to go with the custom policy only. Okay. So some user has a client ID and client secret. Some user has basic authentication details. Then in that case, we have only one option to go with the custom policies. We can't go with the out of the box one. Okay.
So can we start the demo?
Yes.
Okay. So let's start with the design center. So using design center, we are going to create a RAML. So we have an option over here, create. So here we have four options, whether we need to create a new RAML specification, or like you want to create some fragmentation. Fragment is nothing but like a traits or a schema, security schema or data type log, those things. If you want to use your separate traits for all the RAML you are going to create, like for the response message will be same for all the RAML in your organization, then you can create a new fragment and others can reuse this. Other whoever creating a new RAML, they can reuse that fragmentation. And we can create a new Mule application. So Mule application also we can create using this option. So we don't want to go to Anypoint Studio to create a Mule application. So this will be like when we will be using this option, like when you want to do some small POC or some you want to test some integration logic, then we can go for this here only option. And now the Anypoint Studio also have the option to create a YAML in Studio only. So it's a vice versa. Or else if you want to create YAML from already you have created in some other environment and you have it in local, you want to export that into Anypoint platform, then you can use this option to import the YAML also. So I have already created some small YAML, so I will be going with that, explaining with that. So it's a very simple YAML. This is used to add two numbers, okay?
Yeah, so meanwhile, I'll answer to the Rahul's question. Yeah, Rahul, automated policies, I told you, right? You want to set some governance, right, for your organization. So all the APIs should have this policy minimum, okay? And let's say that is one scenario. Second scenario is, let's say you have 100 APIs already deployed, okay? Now you want to apply one policy. So then what is the option? You can go to the 100 each and every API and start applying the policy. Okay, that is not feasible at all. Okay, that is not at all allowed. So what you can do is, in case of that scenario, you can go to the automated policy, set the requirement there, and all those will be applied to all the 100 APIs. That is one thing. And the second thing is, once you apply that, the future coming APIs, right, whichever APIs are creating in the Anypoint Manager, that policy will automatically apply. So you don't need to, you know, worried about that policy at all. So that is the automated policy requirement. Okay.
Yes, thanks, Ashish. So this here, we are going to, this is the place we will be writing the YAML. And so if you want to import, like we have an option over here, we can import a new YAML in your local system. Like we can choose a file, either file or zip, we can choose over there. Or you want to import from Exchange, like already developed YAML, you want to import and you want to reuse that one, you can choose that part. Or you can download this application also. If you choose or download, it will get downloaded. So you can use it in other applications, like how we are trying to import, right? So we can use it in other API specification also. So suppose you want to rename the application. So these are the options we have. We can delete also, duplicate. These are the options. And so suppose if you want to, so here we can create a new files. So if you want to add any traits or resource type fragmentation files, so this option will be used to create those fragmentation. So if you create simple, it will get created. And you can write your traits function over here. So right now I'm just editing. Suppose you want to add some dependency from Exchange. So you want to add some basic authentication or something from which is already built or already present in Exchange. So just go to this option. So here, click add dependency. So if you search for what you want, so basic auth, if I choose, I will be getting that. Just click and add dependency. So it will get added to your YAML specifications. Okay. So this is a way we will be creating a YAML. So and here, yeah. This is the mock service. Yes, Ashish.
Yeah, adding to that, so why we are creating fragments and why we are sharing it. So if you go to the organization level, some data types will be common. For example, I am working for a bank, okay? So account data type will be always common for all the APIs, right? Wherever I am using the account or transaction or customer, all these data types will be common. So I can create those data types and everything in one YAML itself. Okay, I don't need to worry about it. But there I'm not achieving any reusability, or I'm not making it more useful for my complete organization. So with the fragmentation, we are achieving the modularity inside your YAML. You are reducing the size of the YAML, first of all. Okay, because I don't know whether if you convert this YAML to OS, Our AnyPoint Studio only supports some size of OS. There is a limitation on the size of the OS file. Okay, I don't know whether it got fixed or not, but you need to decide the size of the file also. Okay, so with the fragmentation, if you fragment it properly and keep those fragments, make it more reusable, then it will be useful for, and after sharing, right, if you are making a standard, so you are saying that account data type has to be this way, the people start using it, right, it's a standard, so it's uniform across your organization. So the fragmentation brings you the modularity, brings you the reusable part, brings you the standardization amongst across your organization. Yeah, that is the beauty of your fragmentation. Yeah, good.
Yes, so we have here the console. So using that, we can validate our RAML whether it's working as expected or requirement. So just so you can, this will create a mock URL. So just give a try. So I have already set up some sample example over here. So it will take that example here. So this is my request payload. And if I hit this, so what I mentioned in the response message, it will print that. So in this case, we can validate our API specification is working as expected. So once you done with the RAML creation, then we can publish that into Exchange. So here is the option to publish to Exchange. Just click. So here we need to mention two properties, asset version and API version. Asset version is like an instance version, and API version is your API version. So I already mentioned the version in RAML, so it is not editable, and this version can be editable. So that's it. So just if you click on publish to Exchange, it will get published. Okay, successfully published. So let's go here and so my API specification has been published to Exchange. So now it is in, if you see over here, the visibility is private. So only I can able to see that or my organization people can use this API specification. So if I want to share this to public, then we need to choose here. We have an option over here. So we can add a user for only to our organization, or else if you want to publish to public, then we can use which version. So the version we can choose and save. So now this API specification is in public mode, so anyone can access this. So, and as Ashi said, we can download a RAML, download this API specification as a RAML, OAS, or Mule connector, or four Mule connector. So we have a four option to download this API specification. Then we have a mock here. Even here, we can see the console. So it's same as the design center console. So we can validate our API specification over here. So if you choose this, it's a URL, mocking service URL. And same, this will also give us it will validate this API specification. Okay. So then once we publish, then we will be import this RAML into our AnyPoint Studio. So importing can be, we can import a API specification RAML from a design center, also from Exchange. So if I go to file, new application, so we can choose which runtime version we need, and we can download our RAML from both. We can download from Exchange or Maven, or we can download from pick up from the local file or from design center. So always it is advisable to download the RAML from Exchange. So I will show you the difference. So I already login into my AnyPoint account. So if I search for my application, So math operator, if I click add, so we will be getting version. If I have multiple versions, I can choose which version of RAML I need to use. So that option we can have when we choose Exchange as a download version. So if I say finish, so I need to give a project name. I will give the same creator API. So, and then we, so finish. So I have some studio error, so it's not able to create a generate flow using that RAML. So, but I can explain you this, like if you download a RAML from any point exchange, then it will be create as a zip folder. So you can see here, it will be create a zip folder inside your project libraries. In this case, if you create, I have some studio error, so I will be create a new application using Design Center. So if I from here, so math operator. So we don't have any option to choose which version of RAML we need. So that's why we always go to prefer for Exchange. So math operator and runtime.
You need to give name to your project.
Yeah, it's choosing. Underscore API. So I will be creating. So no. Okay, I think not added. Let me import that. So if I create through a Design Center, you can see our RAML is come under main source, main resources as a folder. So there's a difference between when you import from a Exchange and the Design Center. So even if you, there is a difference, like if you click, if you want to update your, like you have added some updated some your RAML and you want to add that those updated version here, if you go to download RAML version, it will update your whatever you have added, like you have a current in your RAML, whatever it is there in Design Center, it will get updated. But in case if you use Exchange option, then you can choose choose which version you need. So if you choose to update a version, then you will be getting which version of RAML you need to update. Suppose you want, like the current version has 5, but you want to fourth version, so you can use through, you can choose over here. So that is the benefit of using creating a RAML using Exchange. So, and then if you, once you create a application using RAML, you will be having this structure. So this structure will have main and the console. So we can use to test our application and our resource folder, resource flow. So inside main, we will be having API kit router. This API kit router is used to validate your request and response messages. And also this is used to send up to proper resources. So like I have multiple resources. So this API kit router is used to validate the request and send to respective resources. Okay. So, and if we mention the error handling, it will be automatically create some error handling in here. So, based on this API Kit audit, all the error handling also been added. So same way we have the console also. So this have API Kit console, and then we have a resource folder. So resource
group. Yeah, just a second, Bhagesh. Yeah, Abhay, answer to your question is, when we are seeing Maven, right? So if you see Exchange, you are going to download the RAMers from your own organization only. If you are selecting a Maven option, you are going to download your Maven, you know, RML from the outside world. Okay. So just like if you don't have any connector in your Exchange, right? Then you go for the Maven dependencies. You add that dependency and then it will get downloaded. It's similar to when you go for Maven. Maven you go for only when if you don't have that connector in your Exchange. So yeah. Anyway, that dependency will automatically get added. But if the connector is not there, then you need to explicitly add that dependency in your form.xml. So here, if you are seeing downloading RML from the Maven, definitely you are going with the outside other than your Exchange. Okay. Now, Balkish, can go to the API Kit router little bit. I want to add there. So since this is a basic, yeah. So here, can you go to the configuration? Yeah. Yeah. So if you see here, HTTP status var name down there, there are two checkboxes. Okay, guys, these two checkboxes, the disable validation. Okay, so this disable validation is a really useful option. Okay, because if you don't check this, okay, if you're disabling right now, means you're saying that you're not going to validate any query parameter, you're not going to validate any header parameter. This can create a blunder for your API. Okay, this looks very, very small option, but this has a real use when your API is, you know, with the query parameters and header parameters, anybody can. During the demo, I'll show you how useful these two options is. Yeah, can you just uncheck that and check the query? You know, don't check right now. I'll show you. Okay. So these two options are really important, guys. When you are deploying it, please make sure these options you are handling. Okay.
Okay. So
yeah, and one more thing.
Yeah.
So how this API Kit router is diverting your request? Can you click on the listener? Can you click on the listener? See here, you'll see something new. API/star. What do you mean by that? So API/star is nothing but all the external calls. You hit any endpoint, you'll come here only. Okay. So how those calls or those hit are getting diverted to the actual flow? So this API Kit router is actually behind the scene using your RAML. And based on that RAML resource path, it diverts your call. Okay, just click on the API Kit router, Markesh. Go to the configuration. See here, this map operator.raml will be getting used. Okay, this API definition will tell you behind the scene that this call or this hit has to go to this. So behind the scene, it uses the RAML file and then diverts the call to the first. It validates the request. Okay, first it validates the request based on the RAML, and then it will divert that call to the appropriate flow. Okay, yeah.
Okay, so just I'm going to add like this add operator, right? So I just need to I'm going to add some here. So I have a two. So from this example, we can see I'm going to send a two inputs to this API. So I'm just calling this API. Hello.input. Yes. Okay. So this will just add my input and give me the sum of these numbers. Okay. So now I'm going to run this in a local. This is my operation, and I need to, here you can choose which runtime version you want to run this application, and the clear. So this option is always never, but it's useful when you choose it as always, like clear application data. So if you choose always, then whenever you are running your application, it will start with a new data, like whatever whatever thing is coming, it will take it as a new. If you didn't choose it this, whenever, for example, if you are using a batch or something in your application, it is throwing some error, and you got that error, you resolved that, even still if you run again, you will be facing the same error, right? That is because the application data, it is taking that from a cache, that's why you are getting those error. So it is always preferred to choose this option as always. And this one also, if you don't want to use your apkit console in any point platform, you just check it, or else you can use it over here. So just apply and run. Got deployed. Just going to run this. So the port is 8081. So we can verify that over here. So the port is 8081. So we can give anything like whichever we want. If we already have application with 8081, then we can choose other options elsewhere. So now I will be using yes. So I'm going to pass some value 3+. Okay, so I missed once. So I got the response as this.
Okay. Okay. Just hold on here. Just hold on here, Balkish. Can you add the query parameter here now? Just go at the end. No, add the haja. Question mark. Say name equal to XYZ. Name equal to XYZ. Okay, run it. Still it is working, right? So this is the problem I was talking about. This is a blunder actually. Okay, this is the injection, we can say, injection problem. With this query parameter, anybody can send anything, okay, which can create, or it can create very big URL or something or something. Okay. Yeah. So this is one problem. Can you go to the header section now? There, sir. Header section. No, not yet. Please hold on. Go back to the postman.
Sorry.
Yeah. Header section. Add one, say client item, client secret. Just do that. Run it again. Did I ask this client item, client secret? No. Did I ask this query parameter? No. So somebody is passing unnecessary in creating problem for me. Now go back. Now go back to your endpoint studio. Yeah. So yeah, go to the API router, API kit router.
One second.
Yeah, go to API kit router. Yeah, just see a header. Sometime it won't work for me. No, don't disable. Just say query parameter strict validation. Just check that box. Yeah, check the header also. If it works right now, default. Click on the default. Yeah. So you can say Raman. Yes. Yeah. So now okay. Okay. Now run it again. Save it. So that's the reason I was saying, right? It's a very useful option. Okay, but generally we'll miss it. Mm-hmm. So that is that we should keep in practice that, you know, this has to be covered properly. When we are, it's okay when we are using our APIs internally. When we are exposing our API, like experience APIs, this has to be properly taken care of. External facing API. Okay. Now run it again. It's failing. See, bad request. Now remove that query parameter and first remove this header parameters. Okay. Bad request. Now remove the query parameter. Now remove the query. No. Keep. Let's go one by one.
Okay.
Now we delete that. Unless you pass the correct input. Now I was telling, right? This header, because of header, it's not working right now. Because if you go to the header, there are hidden headers actually. So these hidden headers are creating problems. So now if you go back, don't remove anything. Okay. Go back to your implementation. Yeah. Remove that checkbox, okay, for headers. It will work in advanced REST client, okay? Because hidden headers are creating problem right now. Now you save it. I told you, right? In Postman, it won't work. But in actual scenario, it will work.
Okay.
Because we are unnecessarily passing the hidden header headers, right, from the Postman.
Okay.
So now if you pass the query parameter, it will fail. If you don't pass the query parameter, it will pass and, you know, it will show you the response.
Okay,
yeah.
Now it's
coming, right?
Yeah.
Now, if you add the query parameter there, it will fail. Yeah. 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 See, so this is really important. It's very small, but it's important. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Go ahead with other options.
Okay. So now we have created a basic application. So I'm going to deploy this application runtime manager now. So we have two options. So we can directly deploy from here. So rightly here, any point platform. So before that, I need to configure the credentials downloading the RAM, right? Before that, we need to configure the authentication for any point platform. So for that, so not here, I will show you from here. So Windows preferences, if you go to any point studio option, there will be authentication. So we can add a number of authentication or like a studio authentication over here. So it will be giving you the page as login, how we will be logging through the web browser, same. So you need to give your username and password and sign in. So this will get an expired in 7 days. So you need to log in again, that's it. So it will be easy. Then I have already logged in into my AnyPoint account. So just I'm going to deploy this application. So deploy to Cloud Hub. So here we need to use application name. And here we need to choose, we can choose the targeting. So it's a free version. So I have only Cloud Hub option, or else we can choose on-premise server or RTF, or whatever we need the target deployment of server, we can choose that. And this is the file, which is, it automatically create the jar file. So if you want to deploy through runtime manager, so we need to export that as a jar and need to deploy. And we have the runtime, we can choose over here, runtime version. So which version we want. And this is the worker, how much memory this application you want to use for this application. We can choose the memory. So how much memory we want. And how many instances we need for this application, we can choose over here, worker. So it's a free version, we are not able to choose, but we will be having option to choose workers also based on the, based on our subscription. So then here, as Ashish said, like we have an option to automatically restart application. So this will avoid the downtime. Like when if some reason your application is down and it stopped at some point, it's needed manually. We need to restart or we need to deploy our application again. Right? But this option, if anything happens like that, so it will automatically restart the application, and we can use Objective Store, so we can disable or enable this application. So this is the way we can deploy our application through Anypoint Studio. So I will deploy through Anypoint platform. So for that, first we need to export this application as a jar. So here is an option. Once you click export, you will be getting an option like a general, and you need to choose mute and this option to export as a jar. So this is my location, which this location I'm going to export as a jar. I can finish. Let me open that. So here you can go and click on Runtime Manager. So here we have in Runtime Manager, we have the option called Deploy Application. Click the. So this will display same as we have seen in that platform. So my application got exported successfully. So I need to give the application name. Operator. Then to choose the cloud version, and I need to choose the file. So export file. As I explained there, so now I'm not going to give any property over here. Here we can mention properties also, like how we will be creating a property in our application, right? So same way we can define the properties over here as well, and we can choose like which kind of loggers you want to see in this cloud up logging. So you want a info based logger or debug based logger, whichever we want, we can choose that. So then I will deploy this. So it's deploying. So whenever if you want to stop your application, or we have an option over here to stop, restart, or delete this application. So we have heard about this vertical scaling and horizontal scaling. So vertical scaling is like when your application need a memory, we will be calling it as when we are increasing the worker size, we'll be calling it as a vertical scaling. and your application need, like you will be receiving 100 messages at a second, and your application we need to accept all the applications. So we need to add some more instances to application to accept all the requests, right? So for that we will be doing horizontal scaling. Horizontal scaling is like we are dealing with this worker size. So vertical mean memory. So VM, you can remember in that way, VM, vertical memory issue, and horizontal means worker size.
It started.
Yeah, it started. So you can get a message also, your application is started. So you will be getting this implementation URL over here. So it's app URL. Yes, I'm going to test this in your platform, say Postman. So I will be getting the response over here. So now this application doesn't have any policies, or it's a normal application. It doesn't have any authentication or anything, right? So if you want to apply some authentication to this API, we need to apply policy, right? To apply policy, we can apply policy only through the API manager. To apply policy, first we need to move our application to API manager. So how we will be doing that? So we have the option over here, manage API. So if you click over here, there is an option, manage API from Exchange, create new API or import. So manage, it's Exchange. So we can choose the application from asset from Exchange, or you are creating, your application is not in Exchange, but you want to apply some policy to that application. Then we can create using a create new API, or you already have an application. So it's all import from it in local service. So I have an application already published to Exchange. So I'm choosing this option. So I need to type. This will give an option. So math operator. So all this will be default. We can choose because we have the RAML, right? We have specified in our RAML all these details. So it will be automatically populated. And now I am using a basic endpoint. So I am going to apply policy to my basic endpoint, and then if you are managing this API using Mule 4 or above, yes we are, so we can check this out. And implementation URL, so you can mention it, or it's an optional if you can mention or not. And the API instance, so this one, like we can give something, so when we have multiple instance, this label will be used as to uniquely identify the instance. So that's why we can, this is also an option. If you didn't mention also, it's fine. And then if you save, so we have managed our application to API manager. So but if you see the API stated, it is unregistered. So to make it active, we need to connect this our API manager with our application, right? So how we will be doing that? What is the key, what is the way we can do? Here it comes like auto discovery. So using auto discovery, we are connecting our API manager with our API application. So we have an auto discovery ID. This is unique for each application. So how we'll be doing that in AnyPoint Studio, if you go to your application, global elements, and you click create, type for auto discovery. So you have to click here. So it will ask two options, API ID. This API ID is from here. So just choose this, copy and paste it over here. And it is asking about the flow. So basically we will be giving the main flow of our application. So call and say okay. So when you are using API auto discovery, these two properties are mandatory. API client, AnyPoint platform client ID and AnyPoint platform client secret. These two properties we need to mention, otherwise your application will not get deployed in Cloud Up. So how you will be getting this client ID and client secret? So in your, if you go to your AnyPoint platform, so go to access management. And choose your organization. So you will be getting organization, domain, organization ID, client ID, and client secret. So I copied from this value. So we can use these values in our any runtime manager to deploy API, the auto discovery based applications. So for that, I will export this. So finish. So it got exported successfully. So
yep. Balkis, one second. Ashish, I had a question for you from one of the chat. I had a confusion in that. So can we deploy the same API ID for multiple applications?
No. Strictly no. It has to be one to one. Okay. So I tell you one thing. Okay. So let's say you created two instances in the API manager. Okay. And now you have two IDs, right? So once you go in the what you can do is same implementation, you can give it to the different interface first at a time only once. So what you can do is you can when you are creating properties there, you put the reference. Okay. So placeholder, and then when you are deploying it, you can deploy with those two values, but only one will get pointed. Okay, so one to one always. No two applications can point to one ID.
Okay, got it. Got it. Yeah.
So it will be application based if you. Yeah.
So in that case, implementation can be same, but the API proxy should be different every time, right?
Yes. Thanks. But in that case also, you should be very careful, right? I was telling you, right? Every proxy will take vCores, right? It will eat vCores. So better in that case, maybe your intention was creating multiple proxies to give those URLs to multiple clients, right? If that is the intention, you can go ahead with the policy called SLA based policies, and then maybe you can create different SLAs for the different client, and then you can share those client ID client script with them. So maybe there we can save multiple vCores. But if your requirement is really very strict to give proxy URLs only, then you have to spend a lot of money. That's what.
Yeah. So if it is an endpoint with proxy, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Then one use case, like I usually tell when using the proxy is like when the implementation is shared by multiple customers. Let's say you have five customers and they are using the same implementation and they have different proxy requirements. And in that case, you might be end up creating multiple proxies. So especially basic endpoint proxy, you can create basic endpoint proxies, multiple proxies, and you can use the same implementation, but the proxies will be different so that they can have their own policy. So one customer might be having one kind of policies. They might not require different policies. If that's a use case, then you end up having different policies.
Yeah, and basically proxy is really useful when you have non-Mulet API.
Yeah, exactly.
So that is what the case. Otherwise, you can go with the basic endpoints because our AnyPoint platform itself is very secure.
Yep. Exactly. And one more use case where you use the proxy is when you are working for a government project or a military project where everything is routed through a proxy, then you need to create an API proxy for sure. Because implementation will be behind the demilitarized zone, and only the proxy will be exposed to the demilitarized outside the demilitarized zone. So that your proxy will be affected, your implementation is still safe.
Yeah, correct. And one more use case is for the attendees. So let's say we are seeing attacks, right? DDoS attack, DoS attacks. So all those attacks, in case of proxy, will be attacked on proxy. Your implementation never get exposed to those attacks. Okay, so on proxy itself, your proxy will go down. But you have multiple proxies, let's say. So one proxy goes down, but other proxy will be able to access your implementation. But if you take that scenario to the basic endpoint, and if your DDoS attack happened on your implementation itself, your implementation is down. Okay, so you are downtime. But in case of proxy, one of your proxy will go down. Or third scenario, if your API is consumed internally, okay, so you'll be giving a actual implementation URL to the internal people, and outside people you'll give the proxy URL. So because of DDoS attack, your proxy URL goes down, but your internal APIs can access your implementation. So there are a lot of pros and cons. Okay, so you need to be, when you're designing it, who is your consumer for your API? That way you need to come up with a proxy or basic endpoint. That's when initially we said this is basic. We are going to discuss all the areas where. So till now we have not applied any policies. Let's go ahead and apply the policies.
So if you see here, if you apply the auto discovery, right, you can see this message like API ID is now unblocked and available. Suppose I have added these two properties. If you not able to, if you didn't add that. Two properties, or there is a key, the secret ID or key value is you have added different, like a wrong one, then you will be getting this message. So it will be giving you rest.
Can you just search for blocked? Just search for blocked.
Control. Oh, if you see here, have to take a screenshot. So. Okay, you can see here your ID is blocked and unavailable. So that client platform client ID and client secret is important to when you are using API auto discovery. So
basically those client ID and client secret does the handshaking between. So in runtime manager there will be agent sitting agent. Okay, runtime agent. That agent will be talking to your API manager. Okay, so then. The connection is happened with the API ID you are connected, but how to authorize that? Okay, so the authorization is happened via client ID and client secret internally. Okay, then only that API ID will get unblocked. If you don't pass that client ID and client secret, you won't get access to the API manager. And
yes, go ahead. Okay, so now the application also started. If you go to Design Center, API Manager. So we can see our API setup is active. So we have created the connection between API Manager and our application. So then we can apply a policy to our application. So as Ashish mentioned, we have three different types of policies. So when we can choose the policy inside your application, when you here, so someone has asked like automated policy. So if you
can you apply the automated policy?
Yes. It will be below your sandbox only. So automated policy. So I have created one automated policy already. So it is a client enforcement policy. So we can, if you see the template over here, we have client ID enforcement cross all these also predefined policies which was given by MuleSoft. So we can choose any one whichever we need. and I have created one policy over here. So if I go to application, and I created the automated policy, right? So now only I created this application. If you go and see that policy section, there will be policies. So there will be already automated policy have been created. So this is the use of automated policy. So if you create any new application or existing application, if you want to apply policy or a policy to all the application in your organization group, you can go ahead with the automated policies. So when you want to specifically use some policy for your, like I have multiple, I have a number of APIs, right? So I want to specifically use different, like want to use a different policy, like this, this application should have only HTTP one, this one should have a caching one, like that. If I want to choose a application based policy, then we will be go to out of the box policies. So the template for automated and so if you see here, template for automated and out of the box will be same. So only difference is this is like we can apply to only one application at a time in out of the box, and automate will be applied to all the APIs in your organization group.
Balkish, one question I want to ask to attendees. Okay, can you go to the policies?
Okay,
so go down. We have two policies. Go down. Down. Yeah. So we have rate limiting policy and we have spike control policy. So earlier, this spike control policy was named as a throttling. So can anyone answer me what is the difference between rate limiting and spike control? And rate limiting? Yeah, so Atul answered the half answer only, Atul. What about the request numbers? Okay. Spike control. Okay. So I give the answer. Maybe yes, all guys are correct. The difference between rate limiting and the spike control is spike control. Let's say you are allowing 10 requests per second. So rate limiting after, I mean, the 11th request, rate limiting will reject it. Okay. But spike control will queue it. And once the next slot comes, if in the next slot, maybe less than 10 are there, it will give the chance to that guy. So spike control won't reject it. Rate limiting will reject it. Okay. So if I allow 10 requests and if I bombarded 15 requests, last 5 requests will be rejected by rate limiting, but last 5 requests will be queued by spike control. Okay. That's what. Go ahead.
Yes, okay. So then if so okay, so we have created this policy, like automated policy. So I will be deleting that and I will create a new one. Here we can remove, we have the option. So just remove it. We'll go to application and I will be creating a out of the box policy for this application.
Yeah, Balkish, tell the use case, okay? So which policy you are going to apply and for what reason?
Yeah. Yes. So I'm going to apply this basic authentication simple. So just a basic authentication. This will be like your username and password, whatever you are setting. So your username and password. Just that's simple application, simple policy I'm going to apply. So if I choose and configure policy, this will ask username and password. I need to provide this username and password. So I just given some username and password and I click on apply policy. So I applied a policy to this API. So if I try hitting this.
Yeah, so. Yeah, meanwhile, Balkish, can you go back to the policies again?
Yeah.
Yeah. So click on add new. So we have basic authentication too, right? We have simple as well as LDAP.
Yeah, basic LDAP. Yeah.
Yeah. Can anyone know what is the difference between these two? Anyone from the audience? Okay, so LDAP, basic authentication, works for group of people. Okay, so whoever is there in that LDAP database, all those credentials will work for the basic authentication LDAP. Okay, in basic single, it will be only for single user. Yeah.
So I applied the policy, but if I try hitting this, I'm not passing any authenticate whenever. Okay, register authentication, so it will take some time. It is requesting us for give the username and password, right? So I will go over here, I will check here basic auth. So once I give the username and password, so I apply the policy for my basic endpoint. So it's working. So if I want to, this is way we can use this one. So I will be explain you when we client ID. Sorry, what's that? Okay. Here. I will remove this. Out of the box policy. So then I will create one automated policy. So create new automated policy. So if I use client ID enforcement, so we have basic LDAP also, right? And we have here also, we have two options like HTTP basic authentication header. So this also same as a username and password. So if you click apply, and override, so it is asking like this application having a different policy, so it's asking override policy for this application. I click yes, then apply. So I applied. So when you use this client ID enforcement, if you want to use this client ID this policy in your RAML, so just if you click on this API specification snippet, you will be get the tries. So we can just copy and paste in your RAML for the and use it over there. So for now I have created this client ID enforcement policy. So here also we need to pass username and password, but this one is not as what I set over here. So if I try hit this application, this will say like invalid client. So I need to pass this also requires a username and password, but not we can't set it our own. We should be using our application client ID and client secret. So how you will be setting this? So just go and to design center. Your application. So here just add a secure, so we have options over here, security schema. So use some basic name for your secure schema, basic code, and choose type. And here we have our options, right? So just choose basic authentication. Then, so you need to add this in your resource. So just click here, secured by, and the name of your security policy. So just add this basic auth. So what is if you try in your mock service, it will show, it will request for username and password. So in mock service, this is just to validate your site. So if you give anything, it will give you the proper response. So it is giving some response. So now I am going to publish this version into Exchange. So we will be publishing to Exchange. So if you see it, the asset version is automatically updated, and we are just need to publish to Exchange. Done. So if you go to here, so math operator, and if you see that API console is showing security, so basic auth we have added. Okay, then so we already moved this application to public. So if you see the version also we have added, version one is having sandbox API, and version mocking service is having this. So we need to choose it as a public to test it over here. So for that, go to API instance and change this version. Okay, mocking version is already public, and sandbox we can maintenance public. Okay. So now we'll try this over here. So I need to pass implementation URL. Okay, I need to pass the implementation URL. I'm just copying from here and add it. So now post. If I choose sandbox, so if I use, before I'm using mock, if I give any value over here, that will give me a response. But if I use sandbox API, then if I try with the same, this will give invalid out client. So we need to pass a username and password. This value we will be getting through. In Exchange, we have an option called request access. So if you click here, here you need to choose your API manager name, and then okay, create new API. So you can give any name over here. So I'm just giving application name and create, and then request access. So I get the client ID and client secret. So copy this client ID and say client secret into somewhere. And close. So now if you pass these values over here, password will be yours. This and client ID will be yours, username. Sent. So you got the response back. So there are different ways of basic authentication. We have different ways, so we can choose whichever, how secure we need, we can choose it over here. So this is the basic, we are applying policy to basic API. So if okay, so this data is unregistered. Okay, so if you want to create proxy API on top of this math operator, So how you will be creating a proxy API for your Mule application, just if you scroll down, you will be having an option, endpoint with the proxy API. Okay, if you choose this, and you need to give the URL, implementation URL. So I will be giving my implementation URL. And then, yes, which version you need. That's it. And schema HTTP we are using. So, and port, save it. So once you saved this, you will be getting option down below, deploy configuration. So you need to choose which version, runtime version, and you need to write a proxy API. So Mac proxy, if it is. So deploy. So this is the way we will be creating a proxy API on top of Mule application. So I can give one more scenario, like how we will be creating a proxy on top of non-Mule application as well. So just. Taking. So it's getting deploying over here. So we have the difference if you see over here. So for applying, when we create a basic endpoint, we have added this properties manually, right? But if you see over here, when I deploy as a proxy, these properties have been added automatically. So this will be taken care of here. And then it got deployed. So if I use this post method, so I'm over here, and I need to pass client ID and client secret. So instead of username, I will need to pass client ID. Sorry. So if I try this, unauthorized. Okay. Let's check away. Username and password, it will not work. Let's go to math operator here. And we have this. If I try sending this, okay. Done. So we have the URL here, and why this not same? We have all the policies also. Let's check the policy. So we have in client ID enforcement. So this should
this value, I give north, access denied, I give basic authentication.
Balkish, can you pass it as a header parameter, client underscore ID and the...
Okay, yeah, yeah, right. Username and password, right? Username, password. Username. Password.
Can you just check whether you copied client ID and client secret properly?
Yes, it is the same. Okay, I think I didn't add it in exchange. If I go over property, so we have instances and this also here. Okay, endpoint. If I use math, why it is? And implementation URL. Well, here it is good. Let me check once, what is that? Request. Sorry. Sandbox. What? Request. It's already there. I'm passing this. Let's try this.
Yeah, you're passing wrong there.
Okay. Still okay. I will choose it non access denied. Okay, I will check on this. Something missing over here. So now I will go. I will let explain how we can create a non-mule application on top of on non proxy for non-mule application. So for that, we are going to use this application. This is a REST-based JSON-based application. So here I'm going to use this single user. So if you see here, if I click on this part. So if I use this user, it will give the response of all the user in this they have added over in the database. If I choose give some number like a 2 or 3 something, it will give the basic. It will give the response based on that ID, give the details for that ID. So let's create a proxy API for on top of this URL. So for that, we need to go to API manager. In API manager, I'm going to create new API. This option I'm going to choose. So here I'm going to create response proxy. So if I choose this, I'm going to choose HTTP API. It's a HTTP API. Then continue. Okay, so here we need to choose it as endpoint with proxy. So which deployment, target deployment we can choose. And as like same as how we are created the API manager, manage API, same you can choose this. So in implementation URL, I'm going to use that. So whatever we are going to use here, right? So I'm going to use this one. So here I will be using till user. And then in advanced version, I'm going to call it. So here I'm using HTTP. So here also I will be using as HTTP in this part. And then port and all the same. So just save it. So now it is in unregistered state. So to activate this, we need to deploy into Cloud App. So just go down, you will be having the option deployment configuration. Choose the runtime version and the application name. So you can create an application name over here. So update application if already required. So deploy this. So we will go to here. This is okay. Prepare to wait. So it's got deployed. So now we'll try this URL. Okay, what I will do, I will just remove that policy we have applied, automated policy. So go to this. Automated policy. I will just remove this and go to elements policy. So if I run this, so now it is giving me a proxy API, but we are getting the response. So the same as this. So if I use this, I give a implementation URL users, right? So if I click here, the response will be same for both the APIs. If I choose over here, I need a one user one details, then I will be getting the user one details over here. Okay. So we can after creating, it will be same as a basic input. So we can apply policy to this application. and apply policy. You can choose whatever you want to use, which policy you want. You can use that one, and like for now I will be using same like basic one, so just use that and test. Configure same and play policy. So it's in active stage. If I try hitting this, okay, it will take some minutes to update. Then so if I try again, it is working. Okay, so it's applied. I will try hitting this application. Why it is not picking the username?
Can you check the logs? Yeah, go to logs. Whether the policy is applied or not. Generally, it takes 40 to 45 seconds.
So, applied policy is applied.
Mm-hmm. Now check.
Okay, now it is giving authentication, so we can give basic auth. And I can so I will be getting the response over here. So if I pass 2 or 3, so it will be giving that ID and that response. This is the way. So if I download this proxy API, right? So if I download this proxy API and I in this jar I will import in. I will be import in our studio. This will look same as a Mule application. So if you see here, so all the structures, everything will be same as our Mule application. You can see. So request and response will be unknown. That is that non-Mule application we have used, and the it will listen to that, send request to that. Sorry. Yeah, this will call that API, that link, and get the request and response from that link, and it will send it back to us. So this is way proxy will work.
Just can you go back to the Enigma Studio?
Yes.
Yeah, go up. Yeah, so the request is actually the request.in call. Okay, the before that, whatever is there, that is, you know, if you know the aspect oriented programming, so that is what we are doing here. Before calling our actual API, we are applying the policies. Okay, on the request, it will get validated. If it is fine, then it will go and get this HTTP request. Inside the HTTP request, it's a URL. That's what the same URL we are building. There will be a configuration property file here in the left side. It will tell you that what is all these values, implementation host, implementation port, all those things. This one. Okay. One more thing, if you see here, API ID, this is 168.75.215. This is the ID of our proxy. Okay. So it's getting connected with the in a non-VLAN. That is. And then after HTTP request, there is a one more after call and before call. So if any policies if you want to apply are already applied, that will be there in the next component. Okay, so here also the API ID and autodescore will be done. Can you go to the global parameter here? It will be there, autodescore. Yeah, see, autodescore. Yeah, this ID is the exact ID of the proxy API.
So I can show you that this ID and
Yeah,
it will be same.
Yeah. And from here, once your non-functional requirement is applied, policy is applied, you can monitor from here. Now the management part comes into picture, where you monitor your performance of the API, how it's behaving. Okay. Yeah, so anything else? Yeah, Ram Krishna, answer to your question is, if already authentication is applied on red risk, then proxy is not the option because we are using proxy to apply the policies on top of it. It's already having policies, then it's really hard to apply a proxy on top of it. Is there a way to do that? Balkish, you have any answer to that?
Sorry, I think.
Yeah, so yeah, his question is, if recurse.in has authentication already, okay, so how to design that? So if you want to do that, maybe in Mule app, you can use this recurse.in, apply those authentication via header parameter or whatever yeah, options, and then you can deploy via proxy. Can you go back to the proxy in API Manager?
API Manager, okay.
When we are creating proxy, I don't think there is option to do that.
When we choose the HTTPS, then we can add.
Yeah, this is different because here we are securing the endpoint. No, his question is, we have used the implementation URL here, right? What if this URL is secured?
Authenticated, okay.
Yeah. So here our intention was to create the proxy to secure the non-VLAN, right? So actually your concern is against that. Right? Then you should not use a proxy. It's already secured. Yeah, maybe. Yeah. So Rajat, I think you gave the answer for this. Can you go back to the inside Anypoint Studio? Yeah. So here in the HTTP request, here you can pass those credentials. Yeah, I got it now. Here header, you can pass the client ID, client security, its authentication, and reply the proxy again. Okay. Yeah, I think that's all. Do you have anything, Palkish, to?
Yeah,
we're running out of time, so we can.
Okay. So that's all.
Anup, you have anything
can
to add?
Can start the quiz soon?
Yeah. We can start because we're running out of time. Already 2 hours are gone.
No, Ashish, I'm good.
Yeah, okay.
So can you start the quiz?
Yes, Patrick, go ahead. First, can you go to the instructions so that people will. Yeah, so a few instructions, guys, all the attendees. If you already own any trivia quiz in last 30 days, please give chance to other guys, because even if you win this, you won't get vouchers. So, and if you are MuleSoft, you know, meetup leader, so please give a chance to other guys. So these are the two conditions we can say that. And yeah, if you are not meeting these two, you can go ahead and participate in the quiz.
Okay. So we have using the Kahoot platform. So just in your mobile, you can log in into kahoot.it. And then in that, there will be in right top corner, there will be a play button. So click on that. So I will be giving you the game pin. So you can enter that game pin over here. And then if once you click on enter, then you it will be asking your nickname. So give your complete name as a nickname so we can find the winners easily. So don't give a nickname as a, please give your complete name.
Yeah, no, Hinky, Pinky, Bunty. Actual names.
And then you will be getting the question in the screen, in laptop, my screen. So this will have the question as well as the answer. In your mobile, you will be seeing only the colors. So you need to choose the color. In mobile, you will not able to see the option as well. So it will be only colors. So you can choose that color by seeing by system. And each question will have only 20 minutes to answer, 20 seconds to answer. So how fast you will be answer, you will be able to get this voucher. Okay. So let's 1 second.
Are you sharing the screen?
Yeah, just 1 minute.
Yeah, it's coming up. Eh? Just a second. He's sharing. It will be there on your laptop screen also. Just a second.
So.
Yeah, after the session, please fill, you know, feedback form that is like, you know, bread and butter for the speakers and other guys. And if you want to, you know, present any session in the meetup, please go ahead and introduce yourself. Here it's the right platform. So please use this game pin and try logging in. So we have 44 attendees. Let's see how many are getting. Yeah, thanks, Rajat. Hey, thanks, Abhishek, for supporting. Bye, thank you. Chala, thank you. Yeah, so 31 I could see. 31. Let's give 5 more. Yeah, 5 more seconds. Yeah. Yeah, bye.
You can start. Still.
Yeah.
Anyone trying?
32, I couldn't see. Just give 5 seconds because I could see 44 attendees.
Okay.
And 33, yeah, it's fine. 33. Anybody is facing any issue? Yeah. 3, 1, 1, 1, 2, 5.
34.
Thank you, Ravi. Thanks for this kind words.
Okay, so can we start?
Yeah, lock the quiz, lock the game. Yeah.
So now we're going to start.
Yes. So guys, for every second, you'll get, I mean, every question, you'll get 20 seconds. Yeah, start.
So Unicorn Design Center is a dash tool to design APIs, REST interfaces, or specification as per the requirement.
Okay, 19 members answered. So next. So congrats Kalyani, Praveen and Abhin, you are the leading. So we'll go to next question. Using runtime manager, you can dash the MuleUp. So, 10 more seconds. Yes, 27 answered, right?
So yeah,
Kalyani, Sridharan, Praveen. Okay, so we'll go to next question.
Read the questions correctly, guys.
Oh, 20 has answered properly. Leaderboard. Kalyani, Sridharan, and Praveen.
Okay. Two more questions.
Okay. Can get top of the only mule based application. Okay, 17 answered. Congrats. So last question. Okay, good. So let's see the winners. Sridharan,
congrats.
Praveen Durk.
Praveen. Congrats, Praveen.
Kalyani Shurava. Congratulations, guys.
Congratulations, all three winners.
Suraj and Abhin.
Yep, yeah. Okay. Congrats, guys. Congrats for winning.
So please share your email ID in the chat. So.
Yeah, please. Kalyani, Praveen. Sridharan, can you? Yeah. Can you take the screenshot, please?
I've taken
Yeah. Oh. Yeah, thank you so much, guys. Yeah, Kalyani, please share your email IDs. Yeah.
So please give fill this feedback form when we will be receiving in your email.
And the coming meetup, we have a very good meetup where Amit Singh will be, you know, speaking about the power of Salesforce. Okay, I think web components, integration with the MuleSoft, with the platform events. So it will be good learning for us, like how the MuleSoft is getting used inside the Salesforce. So please join us on May 15th. It should not be May 15th. It's not May 15th.
June 6th. Yeah,
June 6th. Yeah. Okay. Please correct it. Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
Please correct. Okay. So please be there and support us. Okay. Thanks. Thanks a lot. And please fill that feedback form. That is really important. And if anybody wants to, you know, speak in the session, please contact us, me or Balkish or Anu. Or you can go to our meetup page where you can contact us any point of time. Thank you so much, guys.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Yep, thank you, guys. Yeah.